The world is slipping into a state of chaos. People and nations are on the brink of war and are desperate to find a path to peace. There are worries about a global financial crisis, immigration, intolerance, exploitation, and extremism. All of this has led to a climate of uncertainty and a worry of catastrophic consequences. Hazrat Mirza Masroor Ahmad, the head of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community, has been paving the path to peace by expounding on the root causes of injustice, the potential dangers of ignoring them, and providing solutions to contemporary issues. On a number of occasions, he has taken the opportunity to warn world and religious leaders, senior politicians, and journalists of their responsibilities regarding these matters. Hazrat Amirul Mu'mineen Ayyadahullahu Ta'ala bin Ashrahil Aziz has spoken to the UK Parliament detailing the peaceful teachings of Islam. Hazur has written letters to senior world figures warning them of the dire consequences of their decisions and outlined steps necessary to establish world peace. This included letters to Barack Obama, President Ahmadinejad of Iran, Chancellor Merkel of Germany, Benjamin Netanyahu of Israel, David Cameron, Prime Minister of the UK, Wen Jiabao, Premier of the State Council of the People's Republic of China, and King Abdullah of Saudi Arabia. A letter was also hand-delivered to the Pope. In June 2012, a historic event took place at Capitol Hill where Hazur addressed leading congressmen, senators, ambassadors, White House and State Department staff, NGO leaders, policy advisors, and journalists. It was the first meeting of its kind in America, where some of the most influential leaders of the US got to hear firsthand Islam's message on world peace. On the 19th of November 2012, Boris Johnson, Mayor of London, welcomed Hazur to City Hall. During the meeting, Hazur and the Mayor discussed various issues, including the establishment of world peace and the true teachings of Islam. In December 2012, Hazur spoke at the EU Parliament in Brussels. The European Parliament is the directly elected parliamentary institution of the European Union. It works alongside the Council of the European Union and the European Commission and exercises the legislative function of the EU, making it one of the world's most powerful legislators. The EU Parliament is composed of 754 members. This makes it the second largest democratic electorate in the world after the Parliament of India and the largest transnational democratic electorate. Hazur's visit to the EU Parliament commenced with a series of meetings with MEPs on Monday, the 3rd of December. First to meet Hazur was Marina Yannakoudakis. Marina was elected as a member of the European Parliament for London in June 2009. She is currently the Conservative spokeswoman on women's rights and gender equality in the European Parliament. She is also a full member of the Parliament's Environment and Public Health Committee. Then Hazur met with Tune Kelam, an MEP from Estonia. Mr. Kelam was the last chairman of the Conservative Estonian National Independence Party. He is also a board member of the Human Rights Institute. Kelam is a founding signatory of the Prague Declaration on European Conscience and Communism and is one of the initiators of the European Parliament's Resolution on European Conscience and Totalitarianism. Lastly, Hazur met with Charles Tannock. Dr. Tannock is an MEP for London and is Foreign Affairs and Human Rights Spokesman for the UK Conservative Delegation. He is currently a full member of the Foreign Affairs Committee, where he is also the European Conservatives and Reformist Group Coordinator. He is also a full member of the Human Rights Subcommittee.
He's a very peaceful man and he makes people feel very comfortable and at ease. His approach is perfect. It's very peaceful, it's very loving. He's a very serene person. When you're with him, you feel this peace. And I think when people meet him and he talks about his message, that we will understand that communities that are different, and we have many communities in London where I'm from that are very different, that they can be together and that they have much to learn from each other and share.
The same evening, Hazur graced a dinner reception held in his honor at the parliament, where people had the opportunity to meet Hazur in a relaxed atmosphere.
I think it might be useful to explain what the problem is in Pakistan in terms of why the Ahmadiyya community are unable to vote in most elections in Pakistan, or at least if they can vote, they have to misrepresent themselves. And this is something that I've taken up with the Pakistan Prime Minister and Foreign Minister when I was in Pakistan in July. And I did note that they seemed to think there was no problem. The only person in the government that I could come across who recognised that there was a problem was Paul Batten. And he wasn't very forthcoming in solving the problem, but most of the politicians in Pakistan say there is no problem. Can you explain why there's a problem?
And just to say that I had exactly the same experience today when the foreign minister, who was a delightful lady, rejected any allegation that there was any problem whatsoever for the Ahmadiyya community. So I've had exactly the same. Yes, Holiness, would you have to comment on that?
So you mean that why Ahmadis don't have the right to vote?
Yes.
The thing is that according to the constitution of Pakistan, you have to declare yourself as, if you are an Ahmadi, you have to declare yourself as non-Muslim. And you have to sign a statement wherein you clearly mention that you, not only that you don't believe in the founder of the Ahmadiyya movement, but you have to use very filthy, abusive language for him. And Ahmadis say, because of this, if we are going to fill this form, we are not going to participate. If there's an election, we have the right of citizen. Being a citizen of Pakistan, we have the right to vote without any discrimination of religion. So until and unless this law is there, this obnoxious law, I should say, is there, hanging on us, we cannot vote as a normal citizen of Pakistan. Because politics and religion is a different thing. You are a citizen of a country, you have the right to vote without any discrimination of religion.
Absolutely.
Right?
Your Holiness, my name is Yang Zhenli, China's democracy activist, former political prisoner. And forgive me for my ignorance. Before tonight, I wasn't aware of Ahmadiyya, and I feel now really encouraged by your belief and the whole movement, and eager to learn more about it. And I have been working for China's human rights for more than 25 years, and fighting side by side with His Holiness Dalai Lama and his people for more than 20 years. So if I may, I don't know if my question is proper or not. As of today, more than 90 Tibetans have set fire on themselves for the cause of their people's freedom. I just want to understand your response to this desperate step of a protest. They are persecuted people. Yeah.
You see, we as an Ahmadi, we as Ahmadis are also being persecuted in different parts of the world, as in Asia, Malaysia, Pakistan, and even there's a law in Pakistan against Ahmadis, which says that if you claim yourself to be Muslim or practice as Muslims do, then you will be imprisoned for 3 years at least. And we are not permitted to hold our conventions. We are being persecuted and killed here and there. Every day, every month, two or three Ahmadis are being killed because of being an Ahmadi. So, and even then, our religion, Islam, says that to take your life is not permissible. We are against it. We are all bearing such a type of atrocities, and we don't protest in this way. And I think that bending yourself is not the way of achieving your goal. You have to face the problem, stand, let the people and the world understand and know what the problem you are facing. And what will you get out of it? You will burn yourself, you will take your life, and according to our belief, to give life and take life is the work of God, the Almighty. So you should not take something which is in the hands of Allah, the Almighty. So instead, you should protest in a way which attracts people of the world. You may attract some people for some time, but that is not the continuous protest which should be shown by a true believer. Right?
Thank you.
Although they have, they according to their belief, they have sacrificed their life, but it would have been much better that they lived in this world and worked for the sake of their religion.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Only a few words. My name is Kees de Kovel, former mayor of our town. I know the movement, Ahmadiyya movement, since 1986 as a very respected community, and I hope that the whole world will be come as they are. Thank you very much.
I think a lot of Europeans have a very monolithic view of Islam, for example. They see only one thing. And I think tomorrow will be a chance for people to listen to a message which is saying, no, hang on, within Islam there are many different people, there are many different thoughts, and extremism is a small minority, and we should not judge based on that. And I think it's a very important platform for that message.
The law as it stands, which requires the Ahmadis to declare themselves not Ahmadi Muslims, but recategorize themselves in order to vote, is iniquitous and inequitable. And as His Holiness said, if you're a citizen, you should have the vote. It shouldn't be anything to do with religion. If you're a citizen, you should have the vote. And that is what I've been saying. I also brought it up in the meeting, the human rights opinion last week. So this is something that I've not just raised once, I've raised on many, many occasions.
I don't know of any other religious leader who has managed to not only speak in Capitol Hill, Westminster, now the European Parliament. That's how historic it is. I mean, in 1 year or so, this spiritual leader, the Khalid Khalifa from Sial Khamis, the Al-Tunis disease, has, but true, only by the grace of Allah, he's addressing all the world leaders, the European leaders, he's addressing all the politicians. So, I mean, you can't convey a message like that as he has done. It's amazing. It is historic.
On Tuesday, the 4th of December 2012, Hazur met with more MEPs, including Jean Lambert and Phil Bennion. Jean is a Green Party member of the European Parliament. She's on the Delegation for Relations with South Asia. The delegation covers six countries, including Pakistan. The purpose of the delegation is to ensure that pressing issues are discussed, particularly with a view to improving relations with the EU. Phil Bennion is an MEP and a member of the Liberal Democrats International Relations Committee since 2007. He is currently a member of the Governing Council of the European Liberal Democrat and Reform Group. He is also chair of Liberal Democrat European Group. Hazur also met with a delegation of MPs, professors and a mayor from Spain. A human rights lawyer from Ireland also had the opportunity to meet with Hazur. Hazur also met with a delegation from Norway, which included Anne Skurshammer, an MP from the Christian Democratic Party, and Bill Taranger, the provincial secretary of the Norwegian Christian Democratic Party. Hazur also met with Ingrid Norstein of Norway.
It is very good to meet a leading person and see the influence he has all over the world, and also his passion for peace and religious freedom is very good. And he was so well prepared, so he knows a lot about Norway and our hometown.
I think your leader, you know, the Khalifa is quite peaceful, and the talk and the whole community, you know, is about peace. And it's, I think it represents very, you know, the core of the Islamic religion, you know, and I think it will help to be aware of this community and the interpretation they make about the religion and the Quran, you know, that I think is more, is closer to what the Quran says, you know, and it's they practice this this peaceful living. So I think it's very important.
Well, to say, I'm very impressed by the openness of the message. I'm extremely admirative and in support of this community, which is for me a real example of tolerance, peace, and an attempt to build a much better mutual understanding between communities.
Well, I think it is an incredibly creditable stance that the Ahmadiyya community has, because when one considers how many people are getting not only persecuted in Pakistan, you know, deprived of their civic rights like being able to vote or, and so on, and have certain jobs, but also are suffering injury and death. I mean, hundreds of people in Pakistan have had that in recent years, and just, you know, now. And I mean, the forbearance and the ability to suffer that kind of persecution and yet maintain the tenet of peace, love for all, hatred for none, is an absolutely commendable stance. And, you know, there are most people in the world are not yet matching up to that forbearance, that resilience, and that ability to maintain the message of love in those circumstances. So it's a fantastic example to the world.
After this, Hazur led the Zuhr and Asr prayers within the parliament. This was followed by a brief meeting with members of other faiths. In the afternoon, Hazur answered questions from a range of media outlets during a 40-minute press conference in the press room of the European Parliament. A number of global media organizations, including from the UK, Spain, France, Belgium and Pakistan, attended.
Hello, I'm Sarah. I'm coming from Faith Matters NGO. Where we work to counter extremism and promote interfaith dialogue. And I was just a question for, I understand that you feel that peace and justice like can be found in the Quran and can be used to counter extremism, but do you think the lessons that you find in the Quran could be applicable to those not of the Muslim faith, and how would you present them to different religions?
You see, the message of peace of in the Holy Quran is a message which should never be misconstrued. You know, if you know the situation, the history of the Muslims, the founder of Islam was persecuted in Mecca for almost 13 years, and he never retaliated. Then, because of that persecution, his followers migrated first to Ethiopia, then he migrated to Medina, around 300 miles from Mecca. And there, Muslims were
living peacefully for some few months or a year. Then the infidels of Mecca, even then, did not spare him. At that time, it was revealed to him, and it is mentioned in the Holy Quran in chapter 22, verses 40, 41, that now the time has come that Muslims should retaliate. And the reason given was that if you did not do it now, these infidels will never leave any church, any synagogue, any worship place, or the mosque intact. They will ruin and destroy everything. So Islam, the very first injunction given in the Holy Quran about this jihad or retaliation was because of this, and it gave the reason for it. That not only you are safeguarding Muslims, but you are safeguarding every religion. You are safeguarding churches, you are safeguarding synagogues, you are safeguarding temples. So we Ahmadis claim that according to this injunction of the Holy Quran, wherever we are needed to safeguard the rights of any religion, you will see us on the forefront.
Thank you. I think that answers your question. So it isn't just about the Islamic world and the Muslim adherents, but also to protect other religions in their freedom of worship peaceably wherever.
I feel that message needs to get more publicity, because especially now, you know, you don't have so much publicity, especially in the UK. Not so many people, when I said I was coming here, knew what the message was supposed to be. So I feel it's a good message I can take back and show that it's to do with everyone.
This is why I say, this is why our slogan is, which was given to us in a short form, although it was a teaching already there, but in a short form it was given to us by this third successor of the founder of the Ahmadiyya community: love for all and hatred for none. And this message is only for Muslim, but for everybody.
I am Ivan Bartolo from Malta.
Malta.
Malta. Malta Television.
Maltese Television.
Malta Television, okay. Yes. I can feel your energy. I know that you are a peaceful man, but I would like to see you more with more influential personalities like the Pope, for example. Is this possible?
If possible, yes, we try. Just last year, I wrote a message, letter to the Pope, and it was delivered by hand to him, mentioning therein that we should all join hand together and try to bring peace in the world. And he has, being his in his capacity as being the leader of the Christians, the big denomination of Christians, he should also come forward and discharge his duty. And as far as we are concerned, we shall be ready for him, always to help him wherever we are needed. Right?
So if you can encourage the Pope to issue the invitation, His Holiness is ready to meet him. I think that's the message that you wish to convey. Is that right?
Yes.
Very good. A gentleman at the back would like to ask a question.
I salute you and encourage. I just put down my sunshade so you can see me properly. I had an accident yesterday. I spent close to 10 hours at the hospital. Because of the importance of this invitation, I took the risk from Geneva to be here. I've read that through your programs and everything. I love it. I'm a bishop, Bishop Dr. Howard, a Pentecostal bishop. I have churches in over 15 countries around the world. We have followers. What I want to ask, I have come to embrace you. Do we really foresee the opportunity to break grounds where Muslims and Christians can work together? I'm a Nigerian. That is the sectarian war that is killing us.
You are Nigerian?
Yes, sir, but I live in Switzerland. Uh-huh. 25 years now. I want to find out from you, through this movement, do you foresee the way forward for us to embrace one another so that we can take this message back to Nigeria? See,
actually, this is what we have been preaching everywhere in the world. And we are ready to come forward, as I have already said. We are ready to help everybody who wants to create peace in the world. Mm. Even we have invited all the leaders of different sects, not only in Nigeria, but everywhere. We have asked all the Christians, all the Muslims, that for creating peace in the world, we should join hands together. And as far as we are concerned, you are always available for this purpose. And provided all other sects or all other religions are also sincere in doing this task. Hmm? If you want to, even in Nigeria, we are now in millions, Ahmadis. But and also from among Nigerians. But you would never see any Ahmadi Nigerian doing anything wrong or doing anything which is against the basic morals or usurping the rights of other human beings.
My name is Koho Melo. I'm a Zen Buddhist leader of a community in Zurich, Switzerland, but I'm Brazilian.
Brazilian Buddhist.
His Holiness, I have experience in interfaith dialogue, and I want to hear you about what is your vision about the importance of these groups of interfaith dialogue.
See, there are common values in each religion. Right? So we should to remove the doubts and the hatred of each other, all the religions should sit together and just tell the beauties of their religion instead of accusing and blaming each other. Right? So if this interfaith dialogues are done in this way, then it is useful for creating the peace in the world. Right.
Christophe Lamfalussy from the newspaper La Libre Belgique. Many people do associate in our countries Islam with violence, calls for violence. What is your answer to that?
Well, because as the prophesied by the founder of Islam, that the time will come when Muslim will not be the practicing Muslim according to the true teachings of the Holy Quran. And at that time, a person will appear and he will bring Islam into its original shape. And we believe that although they are giving some violent teachings or they think that Islam is violent, but actually there are wherever there is any injunction in the Holy Quran which states that you are allowed to fight with somebody, that is not to fight but to retaliate. So never be offender. So we believe that we Ahmadis are spreading this teaching, and this is the true teaching of Islam of non-violence. If all the Muslim groups or sects realize or read the true teaching of Islam, they would never behave like this as they have been behaving nowadays. And not only Muslims, but every religious group should behave in a way to respect each other. Right? This is the message we have been trying. So you cannot achieve the target, but we are not disheartened. We are not going to give up. We shall continue. For the last 3 years, we have been doing it. And we shall continue until and unless we achieve this target.
And let's hope that the extremists could listen to His Holiness for once. That would be good, wouldn't it? That would make us all very happy. Gentlemen over there.
Hi, my name is Mirza and I work for a young group of newspapers and GeoTV. I would like to ask you your thoughts on the situation in Pakistan. especially with reference to the different religious minorities that have been under attack all along, but quite
The Islam is a religion which respects each other. Even in the Holy Quran, it says to Christians that at least you come at the and on those common issues, on those issues which are common between you and us. So Islam teaches you to behave in a manner which is which brings the peace in the society. So if minority groups are not being given due rights, as the news says every day we read on the newspaper and listen on the television, then they should try to follow the true teachings of Islam. Pakistan is an Islamic country, and it is expected from the clerics on the leadership, whether it is a religious leadership, Muslim ulamas, or political leaders, that they should behave in a manner when true teachings of Islam are shown. Right?
I think it's true to say as well, because this is one of the reasons that we're having this, is that in Pakistan, where many of the Ahmadi Muslims have their origins from, there is still ongoing persecution. I understood yesterday from His Holiness that every month there's always somebody from your community there who's been either attacked or murdered.
Even last night, some miscreants attacked on our graveyard and broke the gravestones of 120 graves.
120 graves yesterday in Pakistan.
And they came with the guns and everything, and with ropes and tightened the person who was caretaker of that graveyard.
It's a real issue what's happening in Pakistan, sadly.
So, tolerance. Islam teaches tolerance. Ahmadis are not preaching anything other than what is given in the Holy Quran. And that is the message of peace. Respect each other. When Islam says, as prophets have come, as I have said, in every country, every nation, then it means all of them came from Allah. So, and if they were from Allah, then and they are big following of those people, at least we should respect them.
As I deal every day with people who have the opinion of, like, Muslims do this, Muslims are, you know, the Quran is inherently violent, that, you know, they don't want to integrate, and all, you know, really negative things. And to hear some, and they don't speak out about extremism, that's a big thing. And to just come today and hear something completely different, you know, with the head of the community being like, all we want is peace, we actually believe it can happen, we've got a plan of how we can see the future and it can actually change things, I think it's really inspiring. I wanted to go home and write a piece about it, basically, and just be like, hey, it's not all bad, you know. I don't understand how there's so much media haven't picked up on this. I mean, we did one story with the BBC about the youth association's poppy appeal, and like, got so much good feedback from the community, but no one else really. They were like, oh, what is, you know, who are these people? And I just think that for all the charity work, I think it's charity work you do, kind of fundraising, getting involved with the Jubilee, like, that went unnoticed, and I think that needs to be brought out.
This is brilliant. When you've been here, and you will see, yesterday I see just for 2 minutes the Caliph, and you can feel the energy of peace when he passed through my person. So I think, in my opinion, this human being is brilliant. It's a gift from God.
Later the same afternoon, Hazul's keynote address at the European Parliament was delivered to a packed audience of more than 350 guests, representing 30 countries. The event was hosted by the newly launched European Parliament Friends of Ahmadiyya Muslims group, whose chair and vice chairs all took to the stage to welcome Hazul. Before the keynote address, a number of MEPs took to the stage and spoke of their admiration of peaceful Islam as advocated by the Ahmadiyya Muslim Jamaat.
I think this is a special time
as His Holiness has pointed out on numerous occasions, conflicts are spreading in the world, and conflicts are generated by difference of opinions, by injustice, and first of all by not turning enough attention to our counterparts, because we are bound to be united in one belief, in belief in God. And every big religion teaches us that you should first honor God and then respect your neighbor. Your role will be very important, not only as an ideology, but in practice, to bring people, different religions and belief together, and to help us discover that, after all, we are all brothers and sisters and children of one God. It is our good opportunity today to stress this message, and I'm happy that members of the European Parliament could contribute to this. It is a message about solidarity, which the European Parliament is spreading, and I hope that today, from today on, this message will be heard louder and stronger than ever.
It is so timely and so appropriate to have this conference on the theme of responding to the challenge of extremism, and especially, of course, in the European Parliament, because the whole message and purpose of this institution, as one of the main institutions of the European Union, is to create unity in diversity. Given the tragic history, especially in the 20th century of Europe, when extremism and hatred led to death and murder, we never forget that. And what we have built and continue to build in the European Union is built on values of freedom, respect for diversity, and human rights, including, of course, very important ones of freedom of speech and freedom of religion.
Coming here today illustrates the thirst for knowledge of religious communities around the world, but the Ahmadiyya community needs to be understood more. It's charitable work, it's thirst for tolerance and understanding, and the individual themes, love for all, peace for all, the understanding between faiths, and I think some of the other themes, the provision of healthcare, the drive to serve humanity without prejudice, the absolute commitment to education for girls and boys, all of the things that we need to understand more about individual religious communities and their work. I was saying to His Holiness earlier today that we don't understand enough about individual religious communities and their work. I've met with the Ahmadiyya community in my own city of London, but we need to get that message across to a wider community. I don't think you can do better than come to the European Parliament and all that that means to get that message across. And I think this all-party group illustrates that message. And I think this all-party group is a very important message to get all of these themes across. More than ever, we need to get these messages across. And of course, we need to tackle those very difficult questions of religious tolerance, political tolerance, more than ever today. So thank you, Your Holiness, for coming today. And you have support, not narrow religious support, but support for your wider themes of tolerance and tackling those difficult questions.
The community is a prosperous, courageous and determined one. Its slogan, love for all, hatred for none, is the welcome antithesis of the hatred and violence perpetrated by a small minority of jihadi hardline radicals. So what is the message of peace that should come out of this conference today? Firstly, the answer to Islamist extremism needs to come from within moderate and reformist Muslim currents, such as the Ahmadiyya Muslim community, if it is to be credible and lasting. Secondly, Europe needs to face up to the unprecedented nature of the threat. Tolerating a flourishing of hardline intolerant voices cannot be the right way. That European society is being tested as never before is a fact, And once we have lost our cohesion as a society based around our cherished values, we are unlikely to ever win them back.
The fact that I speak about the need for peace and mutual love is not because of any new teaching brought by the Ahmadiyya community. Whilst it is certainly true that to bring peace and reconciliation was one of the major objectives of the advent of the founder of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community. However, the reality is that all of our acts are due to the teachings that were revealed to the founder of Islam, the Holy Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessing of Allah be upon him. I believe that the cause of such conflicts and deviance is not only religion or beliefs. And it is not merely a question of differences between Western and Muslim nations. In fact, a major root cause of the discord has been the global financial crisis. When there was no recession or credit crunch, nobody ever bothered about the influx of immigrants, Muslims or non-Muslims, or Africans. But the situation is now different, and that has caused all this thing. It has even affected the mutual relationships of European countries, and so anger and resentment between the people of certain European nations and the people of other European countries is increasing daily. This state of despair is visible everywhere. The formation of the European Union has been a great achievement on the part of European countries, for it has been a means of uniting the continent. And so you should make all possible efforts to preserve this unity, for by honoring each other's rights. The fears and worries held by members of the general public must be removed. To protect each other's society, we should be willing to accept fair and just demands of one another. And of course, there should be fair and just demands by the people of each and every country. Remember that the strength of Europe lies in its remaining united and together as one. Such unity will not only benefit you here in Europe, but at its global level will be the means for this continent to maintain its strength and influence. Neither is a European greater or superior to any other national, nor are Africans, Asians, or people of any other part of the world. Differences of nationality, color, or ethnicity act merely as a form of identity and recognition. The truth is that in the modern world, we all depend upon one another. Today, even the major powers like Europe or the United States cannot survive by remaining completely isolated from all others. African countries cannot remain isolated and hope to flourish, and neither can Asian countries or the people from any other part of the world. For example, if you want your economy to flourish, then you must be willing to embrace international trade. A clear example of how the world is now interlinked is illustrated by the fact that the European or the world's financial crisis of the past few years has negatively affected more or less every country of the world. Furthermore, for countries to advance in science or to excel in other fields of expertise requires them to cooperate and help each other. We should always remember that the people of the world, whether they are from Africa, Europe, Asia, or anywhere else, have been given great intellectual capabilities by Allah, the Almighty. If all parties utilize their God-given faculties to the best of their abilities for the betterment of mankind, then we will find that the world will become a heaven of peace. However, if the developed nations try to suppress the growth and progress of the less developed or developing nations and do not give opportunities to the fertile and bright minds of those nations, then no doubt anxiety will spread and the ensuing restlessness will ruin international peace and security. Islam teaches that peace can only be established by helping both the oppressed and oppressor in a manner that is completely impartial, free from vested interests, and devoid of all enmity. Peace is made by giving all parties an equal platform and playing field. All forms of cruelty, wherever they exist, must be eradicated and stopped, regardless of whether they are perpetrated by the people of Palestine, the people of Israel, or the people of any other country. The cruelties must be stopped because if they are allowed to spread, then the flames of hatred will surely engulf the entire world to such an extent that people will soon forget about the troubles caused by the current economic crisis. Instead, they will face a much more horrifying state of affairs. There will be such a huge loss of life that we cannot even comprehend or imagine. Thus, it is the duty of the European countries who suffered great losses during the Second World War to learn from their past and save the world from destruction. To do this, they must fulfill the requirements of justice and be willing to accept their responsibilities. Islam strongly emphasizes the need to always act in a fair and just manner. It teaches that no party should be given preferential treatment or favored unduly. It should be that a wrongdoer knows that if he tries to act unjustly towards any country, no matter its size or status, he will not be allowed to do so by the international community. If the member states of the United Nations, the countries that derive benefit from the European Union, and the countries that are under the influence of the big powers, all come to accept this, or even the underdeveloped countries, then and only then peace can emerge.
Martin Schulz, MEP and President of the European Parliament, also came to meet Hazur Akdis.
We have been graced with the presence of the President of the European Parliament, Mr. Martin Schulz, who has come to personally greet His Holiness and congratulate him on his speech. Well, thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you, Your Holiness, for that very inspiring, wide-ranging speech. I have to say, you touched on so many topics. You mentioned all sorts of issues to do with the true Islamic message on peace, on tolerance, on issues as wide-ranging as development and the need to be charitable to countries which are poorer and the special responsibilities which fall upon Western countries, particularly European Union member states, to discharge their responsibilities in a thoughtful and charitable and peace-building fashion. I have to say that was an extremely well-received message. And I was also intrigued and perhaps slightly surprised where you boldly and bravely took on the message of immigration. As a politician in my country, that is a major issue now, the issue of large movements of people into our societies and the need for mutual understanding, to build bridges, to have better tolerance on both sides. And I think that is the important message we need to go away with today.
The historic event concluded at 4:35 p.m. with a silent prayer led by Hazur.
Ae Masiha nafas, ae mahe dil bara, ae Masiha nafas, ae mahe dil bara,
Under the guidance of Hazrat Khalifatul Masih, Ayyadahullahu Ta'ala bin Nasrahil Aziz, the Ahmadiyya Muslim community is continually engaging in dialogue and extending their hand of friendship with people of all backgrounds to help promote a spirit of social cohesion and to remove many of the misconceptions prevalent about Islam.
I've had the privilege over the years of going to a lot of events such as this, but when His Holiness finished, there was a feeling in that room, a huge room full of people, but there was a feeling that I've never experienced in my life before. Everybody was obviously very thoughtful and considering the words that had been used. There wasn't wild euphoria or anything like that. There was a deep sense of that man has said important words today. I found it very moving.
It's a very thought-provoking day. I've enjoyed it thoroughly. I think the message of peace and tolerance to everybody is a vital one for the world. I come from a generation that lived through a nuclear crisis in the past between Russia and the West, and I would hate to see that situation develop again anywhere in the world. I think it's vital that we try and develop harmony.
I love this person. I love the words of wisdom that came out from his mouth. I believe I will declare it, since I have actually been working with both Muslims and Christians and all religions, I've never met a man like this who is so milk, who speaks peace. And that through him today, I got to know that Muslims can actually be respected. Extremism is a personal thing, only if you allow it to go into your head. And that is what we are suffering back in our country, Nigeria. As a bishop, personally, I don't hate Muslims. I will tell you, I used to be afraid of them. But from today, as I met His Holiness, through his address to the whole world, I am going to try, it's a declaration, to work with a Muslim Islamia in Switzerland. The president invited me here. We're going to work together. It is a sure deal.
Well, I think it's rather symbolic in bringing together the venue, the European Parliament, which is one of the main institutions, obviously, of the European Union, which is founded on the principles of respect for democracy, the rule of law, human rights and civil liberties, including freedom of speech, freedom of belief, and the Ahmadiyya Muslim community, whose whole approach and whose whole outlook is about respect for each other, for the rights of every single person to express their religion and to live in peace. The whole message of peace, that's what we've built in the European Union after the disaster of war and devastation. And you know, so there's a neat, if you like, confluence of values here. The EU and the Ahmadiyya Muslim community, I think, are inspired by and seek to practice those same values of tolerance, of peaceful coexistence and mutual respect.
Well, I think it is a recognition of the Caliph's thoughts at European level. We have seen that at the US Congress level and the German Bundestag in the British Parliament and so on. So I think the political community is recognizing an active participant in the Muslim world, which is against terrorism, which believes in unity and fraternity amongst all peoples, independent of creed, and that is extremely positive. And this event, I think, is an official recognition, which is of a certain importance.